Washington Post reporter Colm Borchers is joining us now from Washington. Okay, here's what I don't understand. Every economist I've spoken to has said there's no way it's going to get to 3%. 2% has sort of been the highest rate. So how can they have an entire budget that's predicated on a goal of 3% growth and cuts to social programs?
Well, it feels a little bit like political posturing in the sense that what they are outlining are pretty harsh cuts that are probably politically unrealistic. Even a lot of Republicans will probably be uncomfortable with cutting funding to programming that might help seniors, like something, say, Meals on Wheels. And so I think what they're setting themselves up for is if the budget has to be scaled back, they're going to be able to retroactively go back and point out and say, hey, well, look, we would have had 3% growth if we had stuck to our plan, but since you guys didn't give us what we wanted, that's why the economy is growing slower than we would have had it going if we had been able to push through our version.
And walk us through this. Why hasn't this sort of made its way through to the Senate at this point?
Well, again, you know, the House is looking at a budget from the president's recommendation that has to get through the Senate, too. And we've already seen that there is often a disconnect there. You look at the health care bill, for example, that made it through the House. It looks like it'll have a much tougher time getting through the Senate. So, I mean, you can do that. But, you know, if you want to think about crafting legislation that has a better shot of getting through the Senate, you might take a little bit more time with it. I think we're in a slightly different phase here, too, in the sense that the president is beyond his first 100 days. And that deadline really seemed to weigh heavily on him. You know, he really wanted to do something big in that period. The health care reform was a big piece of that. Now that that deadline has passed, there's perhaps a more willingness to take your time with some of these legislation.
We just heard from Mulvaney with this idea that it's the people that are paying the bills that are the ones whose perception should matter here. How's that being received right now on Capitol Hill?
Well, again, it makes sense, but the problem is that some of the specific provisions of the bill won't necessarily be popular with the people who are paying for the bill. So that philosophy on its face is a good one, but the problem is that when it is scored, what the president needs to be worried about is that those people who are paying for the budget are going to look at specific provisions and say, well, I don't like that, or I don't like that cut, and then they're not going to be willing to do it. And so, you know, it's one of those things that sounds good, but in actual practice might not pay off quite as well as Mulvaney is hoping.
It even sounds like, you know, with Trump, it was the disenfranchised who supported him, but so many of these cuts are for the disenfranchised, are to help them, and they're going to be the ones who suffer in the long run.
Yeah, I mean, farmers, for example, are looked to be one of the big losers in this budget. Of course, I'm generalizing here, but a lot of farmers in more rural communities in red states formed a key part of the president's base. And so this is the risk that the president runs. Keep in mind that as we've looked at his polling numbers as far as approval rating goes, he's staying very popular with his base, but he's not growing the base, which means there's a very little margin for error there. He really can't afford to turn off any of the people who did vote for him because he's not picking up people who didn't.
Yeah, budget to health care, hard to see where this is going and through the Congress here, through the Senate. I want to ask you, though, I want to switch gears and ask you about the investigation into Russia's role meddling in the elections. We heard Michael Flynn today decided to invoke the Fifth. We know he's going to do that and not even turn over some of these papers. Can he do that? We know he has the right to take the Fifth, a legal right to take the Fifth, but does he also have a legal right to say, I'm not turning over anything?
Yeah, it doesn't so much cover documents. The Fifth Amendment, keep in mind, protects you from making incriminating statements about yourself, but it does not protect you against statements that you have made in the past. And that can include documents. And so what the Intelligence Committee has tried to do as a workaround to this is say, okay, well, if you're not going to comply personally with a subpoena, we're going to issue subpoenas to your businesses. And they think that they can sort of get around General Flynn's unwillingness to cooperate himself.
We heard the Senate Intel co-chair and chair yesterday say it's not their job to grant immunity. Is there a way of guessing where this goes with Flynn?
Boy, it's hard to say because what is sort of confusing about the matter right now is how much fire really goes along with the smoke here and whether some of his lack of disclosures earlier were just a matter of responding to the political atmosphere. I mean, we've seen this from some other members of Trump's team, too, whether it was Attorney General Jeff Sessions, maybe not being quite as forthcoming about contacts with Russia. You know, was that really because there was something to hide, or was it just a matter of an awareness that, well, any admission of contact contact with Russia is going to look bad in the current political environment. Maybe there was nothing nefarious about it, but I just don't want to put it out there because I know that it's going to look bad.
As it relates to the Russia investigation, also reports today that the president has hired outside counsel instead of using White House counsel as it relates to those matters. What should we read into that?
Well, I think what it shows, once again, is that the president has a relatively small inner circle of people that he trusts. And Mark Kasowitz has been his attorney for 15 plus years now. He's someone that he really trusts. And he's still building that relationship with some of his internal attorneys at the White House. And so I think this is a pattern that we see from the president in a lot of ways, right? You look at his internal circle of advisors, a lot of them are family members. You know, you look at, for instance, even the thought today that he might bring in somebody like Corey Lewandowski to help with crisis management. That's not a particular area of expertise for Lewandowski, but Lewandowski is someone that the president has a good relationship with and somebody who he trusts. That dynamic seems to be something he places a real premium on, perhaps even above expertise.
Callum Borchers of The Washington Post, thank you.
Glad to be with you.